All right, good evening or good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second day of our Sanaa Music Workshop. We're so excited to have you here. Today we're gonna have our class presented. We have Ms. Emily Fredrickson in the house, and she's gonna be talking about artistry and artistic burnout and how to keep motivated in this, in 2021 as an artist. Before we turn it over to Emily, just wanted to shout out a couple donors here. We have the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation. We have the Emerging Philanthropists of New Orleans. We got the 40 Schools in partnership with Vela, the Bornstein family, the Anderson family, and the Cara family. And a huge shout out to those organizations and families who donated to us, because this year we're presenting the camp 100% free. And if you are watching online and do enjoy the programming and what we're doing here at Second Line Arts, please go to secondlinearts.org and donate. But without further ado, we're going to turn it over to the great Miss Emily Fredrickson.
Thanks so much, Greg. How's everybody doing this morning? I know that we're all on mute. Good, thumbs up will work. That's beautiful. Thank you. As Greg said, I am Emily Fredrickson. I am a trombonist, composer, and arts advocate, and I live in New Orleans. And today we're going to be going over a topic that maybe seems a little different. At first, it's going to seem a little uncomfortable, but I just need you to write it out with me. It's going to be fine. It's going to be a little strange at first, and maybe not like most of the other workshops. I promise that it's going to be something that is very valuable, especially after you leave the education part of your career. So I think if it's okay with you guys, I know that there are, how many of us there are? 16. So it's too many for everybody to introduce. I would love to talk to all of you at some point, but I am going to randomly select, there's almost 20 of us. I'll use my little 20-sided die to pick a few people to go ahead and introduce yourself. If you could say your name and why you play music. So I'm gonna roll my dice real quick. Number 9. Okay, do we have Jason here? Jason Williams? No? Okay, let's try it again then. Okay, Haywood, can you introduce yourself and say why you play music?
Hi, I'm Haywood St. Cyr, and why I play music? Well, I don't just play music, I make it too. Like, I want to be a world-renowned music artist, rapper, singer, etc. And I do it as a form of release and stuff, and a way to get out my emotions and express myself to the world, and to help others too, like, because music is relatable and it's universal. So like, if you listen to my music and you have the same struggle, then like we can connect on that way. So it's a connection too. So yeah.
Beautiful, thank you, Haywood. All right, let's see. Okay, number 13. Oh, Cameron Clark. Let's hear from you. Hey Cam, you there?
Yeah.
Hey, there we go.
Cam. Yeah, I'm here. I'm Cam. I play trumpet. I just graduated from Loyola, and I think I like to play and just create music in general, because like it's just something that's just core to my personality and my soul almost. Just in everything that I do, like I just hear music in everything, whether it's like birds chirping or like a train horn. It's just in my nature to create music. So that's why I do it.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. Let's see who's next. Okay. We have Valerie.
Hello. I'm Valerie. I'm from Bolivia and I go to Loyola. I make music because it's what I've known and loved my entire life. It's a release and a language.
Beautiful. Thank you, Valerie. All right. Let's do one more. Do we have, let me scan real quick. We have Dominic? No, we don't have Dominic. Okay. Oh, we do have Dominic. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead, Dominic.
I find learning music to be enjoyable. The act of learning it. Yeah.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, I have to be honest with you guys. When people would ask me that question, especially early on in my career, I thought the only acceptable answer was I play music because I have to. And that's not a super healthy relationship to music, because then it sort of seems like it's a chore. But I can say today that my answer, I play, I write, I compose, I arrange music because I love it. And that's one thing that I can always rely on. I play it, I write it because I love it. And sometimes my relationship to music has really changed. It used to be because I loved playing the trombone for people. And then I kind of lost that for a little bit. And then it used to be because I love arranging music for a big band. And then I sort of lost interest in big band. So I think the one thing that I can always derive is that I play music because I love it. So we're going to discuss something that's a little different. I don't know, maybe different from your normal lectures or workshops, something called burnout. Has anybody, just by show of hands, you can give me thumbs up or whatever, has anybody ever heard of burnout, known someone that's gone through it or gone through it yourself? I have. Yeah. Great. Okay. That's definitely a good starting place. I personally did not really know what it was. And I thought for sure, because I'm super smart and I'm really good at, you know, taking care of my stuff and staying on top of everything, that I would never face it because I thought I was immune, and that was not true. And I think it happens to a lot of people, especially artists, and I don't know that we're prepared super well to deal with it. And it actually isn't something that I think a lot of people want to talk about, but unfortunately I think it's something that, and we'll go over why, but I think it's something that artists are especially susceptible to. So over the next two classes, which is this morning and then Thursday morning, we're going to go over three things. We're going to learn how to recognize the symptoms and patterns that might indicate burnout. And then we're going to go over how to set goals with a different mindset than what you're used to. And then Thursday, we're going to go over something that I call having like a well of ideas. So basically creating a bunch of ideas that you have saved up that you can use when inspiration is low, when creativity seems like it's all gone. Having something saved up and ready, that's kind of key for those moments. So I think all of those things are especially useful for avoiding burnout. And that's ultimately the goal of what we're gonna try and go over. So honestly, there's not gonna be a lot of right answers. So if I ask for an answer, just kind of give me what's at the top of your head. And I know Zoom is super hard, so don't worry about interrupting. We'll try and make sure that everybody gets a chance to talk, and I'll try and mitigate the interrupting Zoom issues as much as possible, but just kind of go for it when you have a chance. So first we're gonna start. I have to apologize because I put your materials in another folder with my name on it that was not the folder that was shared with you. So you don't actually have to have anything prepared for today. Don't worry, obviously. I didn't realize that it wasn't in your folder until last night. So all of the references and things that I'm going to talk about today are in that folder. You don't have to open it up now. You don't have to find it right now. But I do want you to know that I'm going to be referencing some material that's kind of scientific, and I'm not a scientist. So I always, always, always recommend that if somebody references something, that you go and check out that reference for yourself, because sometimes people interpret it differently than you would. And I think it's extremely valuable to have practice referencing things that people have, referencing them for yourself. So it's just a book and a podcast, or two books and a podcast. They're both pretty short. The podcast is really easy to listen to as well. So if you'd like to listen to that after today, that would be great. But we'll start where all of our music is supposedly supposed to start, with emotions. I don't know if I've ever had a great definition for what emotions are, but according to this book, and this is the one that I'm referencing, Burnout, emotions are chemicals in your body. I don't like that because I don't really like the idea that I have to deal with emotions. So when I hear that they're actually just chemical reactions in my body, that makes it a little bit easier for me to understand and deal with, because emotions are just not something you can really nail down and explain, and it's not the same for everybody. So when I heard that, it actually made me have like a little bit better relationship with the concept of emotions. And that's good, because musicians were essentially training to use our bodies as vehicles for emotion. And I think because of that, more so, artists are extremely susceptible to burnout, because we're required to not only process our own emotions, but then refine the process into a highly skilled performance and do it for a living. So taking a second to digest all of that, we have to process our own emotions and refine it into an extremely skilled performance or writing and do it for an audience and make money off of it. That seems like a little unreasonable. I mean, it seems like a lot to me at least, but it's what we've chosen to do. And I think most importantly, when we think about how overwhelming that all sounds, is to go back to our why. Why are we doing this? So moving on a little bit more than that, can anybody give me like a short definition of what you think burnout is, or if you've experienced it before? Just anybody, you can unmute, just raise your hand or whatever works.
I think burnout comes from like doing something that you may have a passion for or a love for just too long. And then you kind of feel like, is this the only thing that I'm capable of? Like, is this all that I do? So you kind of have those thoughts of like, you know, let me like maybe pick up something else, or like maybe take a step back from it for a while, because you're just like, I need to take a break so that my entire personality does not revolve around like this one thing. I think that's where it kind of stems from.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. Does anybody have any other aspects that they want to share about what they think burnout is? Go ahead, Matthew.
Burnout kind of comes from like playing music and doing like from the same thing, but of course something else. And then sometimes you have self-doubt, and that leads to like periods of like laziness and stuff like that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. I definitely think that the laziness is what I equated with burnout too. That's what I started recognizing it as. I thought it was just being lazy. So the definitions from this book, and then also from scientists who study professional burnout, which is, this is kind of a spin on it, artistic burnout. The signs of it are, the first sign is emotional exhaustion, decreased sense of accomplishment, and depersonalization. And I'll take a second to explain that. Emotional exhaustion is the fatigue that comes from carrying too much for too long. So yeah, I think that's something that we can all recognize. It's just like, okay, well, I'm a little tired of this, or maybe I've done too much. Maybe I took on too much. Decreased sense of accomplishment. This one hit home for me. The unconquerable sense of futility, feeling that nothing you do makes any difference. Whew, that's tough. That's definitely tough. And I feel like that, especially when I was in school, I felt like it got to the point where I was just like not doing anything right. And then the depersonalization is depletion of empathy, caring, and compassion, which is so dangerous. And it's really important to being a musician, is to have empathy, caring, and compassion. It's a super important part about what makes us relatable, and how we, you know, make our message through our music. So,
hey, Emily, what about like, you know, feeling like you want to quit, you know, or feeling like there's no point? I don't know if some of the cats can talk about this, but for me personally, when there was the pandemic and there's nowhere to play, all of a sudden there's like also no point to practice, or there's no point to even create. Maybe some of the men and women in class can talk about if they felt like that before.
Yeah, please, I'd love you to share.
Yeah,
Cam.
Yeah, I think I can touch on what Darren was talking about, because definitely during the pandemic when there was like no gigs, or like I had gigs and they just were like canceled, I was like, all right, like, is this like a viable way to like make a living? You know what I mean? Especially like if the gig industry is like as unstable as it was like during the pandemic, I was like, is this something I necessarily like want to continue doing? I was like, do I want to go do like business stuff or whatever? So yeah, definitely that feeling of like quitting is definitely also an aspect to burnout.
Yeah. How about you, Valerie?
I think it happens when you like don't know how to balance learning between like expressing your creativity, because there's just so much time to be spent sitting down learning an instrument, learning theory, you know, practicing skill, but then if you stress yourself too much with that and you don't make room for like your own expression, it can be a bit like a burnout, I think.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, they're right, huh? It's hard, man. And it's, you know, you guys are just at the beginning of your career. Me and Emily and Greg, we've been out here for a minute, and it's kind of cyclical. Mm-hmm. You know, like it can be anything. It could be you broke up with your girlfriend or boyfriend, your dog died, mm-hmm. They didn't have the right sandwich at the damn grocery store. Like anything can kind of trigger, you know, burnout or some kind of emotional depression that can lead to burnout, you know? What do you think, Emily?
Yeah, absolutely. Mason, I saw a hand. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think burnout can also come from sort of forgetting why you started in the first place, because that can often happen if you're like, especially in like music school or doing stuff where like you have so many assignments, doing all this work, and like you realize how much work you have to put in to get where you want to be. And if you only focus on that work and like what you have to do or what you're having to do, and you forget like why you even in the first place, and you're gonna burn out because you're gonna be like, what's the point?
Absolutely. Yep. And thank you so much for transitioning into that, because that's where I was, and why especially I wanted to talk to people who are just kind of starting or coming out of college, because I left my undergrad thinking I was not going to be playing music again because I was so burnt out. And I moved to New Orleans to not play music, which obviously didn't work. It's kind of a hard place to do that. But I think that the important part of it is, yes, remembering your why, absolutely, but also being okay with your why changing. I was not okay with it changing. I didn't like the idea that maybe I didn't have to play music. Maybe there's another reason why I like this. Maybe it's okay that my why is that I love it, and that's enough, you know? Go ahead, Pef, I see your hand.
I just want to include, I feel like burnout for me is mostly about impatience. There's that, you know, super common cliche, you know, it's not about the destination, it's about the journey. And, you know, when you really want to, I remember like there was a point in time when I really wanted to learn how to kickflip on a skateboard. Still don't know how to kickflip, but I just wanted to get there, you know, and I kept trying to do it. And the more I tried to do it, the worse I got at it, until I was just like, I hit the ground and I was just like, I'm so done skateboarding. Like, you know, like, just like, you know, that feeling where it's just like, you know, you want to get there, but you're not even living within, you know, the process of getting there. And it causes that burnout.
Yes. You actually, thank you, Pef. It's good to see you. You actually transitioned this perfectly into the next part of this. So the idea of burnout, it stems from something called exhaustion. And exhaustion, as we all know, is a physical condition, but it's sort of hard to remember that emotions are also physical conditions. They are chemicals in your body and they can cause exhaustion. So when I hear emotional exhaustion, I'm like, okay, well, that's whatever, you know, that's just hippie, whatever. I can get through emotions. I can handle that. No, emotions are chemicals that are happening in your body, and they can cause the same exhaustion that happens when you're skateboarding. And you get to the point where your body just physically cannot do the kickflip anymore. You have to start over the next day, just give yourself rest. But that is exactly what happens. And then you said you get stuck in the process. You get anxious because you're stuck in the middle of it. That is literally and chemically what happens with emotions. You have to go through the beginning, middle, and end of them to fully process them. And this is something that is sort of like, again, please reference, because I am not a scientist, but from what I've understood, it's an evolutionary reaction that our body has to stress. We have emotions so that our body responds appropriately. So when we're stressed, those emotions actually come from basically avoiding danger, avoiding enemies. If we go way back to, you know, the, you know, times when we were running from animals that were trying to kill us, those types of things, you know? So the emotions are actually something that we have to physically process, and our body's response to them are still the same as it was when we had emotions from just being afraid of something. So to process them, we actually have to go through the physical response of feeling like we got away from whatever was endangering us. And then we have to go through the response of safety, making sure that we feel safe. I know this is a little bit complicated in relation to music, but when we talk about how stressful playing this music is, when we talk about how the ideas that we get on stage and we bare our souls every night, we're literally forcing ourselves through emotions over and over again. But I don't know that we always are able to successfully process what they feel like. And it can lead to that exhaustion and that feeling like you're getting stuck and that feeling like you're impatient. So does anybody have any ideas? Or can you tell me a little bit about how emotions play into your practice? Has someone ever told you, oh, play with more emotion? Or how does that play into what you do as a musician? Uh-huh. Go ahead, Brandon.
Brandon, you're muted.
Oh, yep.
I can't hear me? All right, cool.
Yeah, there you go.
All right. Thanks. So it's kind of it's a little strange for me because a lot of us were in college or high school or getting out of college. We've been taught pretty much our whole lives almost, like not even just music, but in a sense of an academic standpoint, we have to kind of learn a certain way or follow a certain roadmap of just learning fundamentals. And then as soon as we get out, everything is just like slapped to the face. Cause it's like going to school and then going to the bandstand, like you're just sitting in with the band, or you're just like, you're going to like an orchestral rehearsal. It's just like, even if you read music, there's just like so much emotion and all of that, like expression, that stuff doesn't just get taught, you learn it. Mm-hmm. And it takes time. And when we think about how we express the music or whatever was written or anything, it's not going to be the same as you first played it earlier. So it's just the mat. So when you first hear that stuff, it's just like, well, how can my brain process what's going on? All of this stuff is different. And it's just something you learn and you learn and you learn. And it's hard to handle, like when you first like experience it, you know. So it was tough for me at least. So
yeah. It was extremely tough for me as well. I think absolutely what you said about things changing so rapidly from an educational setting to just being out there, that was a huge emotional switch, because now not only is it went from being your grades to now it's my rent. Like this is feeling pretty serious, you know. That pressure is another thing that builds up external emotion that happens off stage, and then you get on stage and you're right, absolutely processing the music and how it changes emotionally as you play it. And then also, right, just like having to manage having a great technical performance on top of that, it's so much, it's absolutely overwhelming. And I don't think, at least in my educational experience, there wasn't a class on like emotion 101, how to handle stuff. There wasn't anything like that. So that's part of it that's like, oh, it's totally up to you. Go ahead, Jordan.
I personally say that as artists and as people, that everything comes down to perception and interpretation, because what somebody feels is melancholy may not be what melancholy is to somebody else. And when it comes to being in a big band and you're trying to convey this emotion for the writer's pleasure, you know, you have to do it because it's what they want. But when it comes down to you being a solo artist, I feel like no one can really tell you how to play with emotion, because it's how you interpret it, how your body and mind processes it. So it may not come off as sad, happy, mad to somebody else, but if that's how you feel and that's how you feel like it's the right way to express it, then I feel like that's what's most important. And with that being said, there's also ways you can better the ways you convey emotions, because I'm always trying to better the ways that I do things. And I feel like the more you find yourself through your music and through your talents and your art and your life, then the better you'll get at conveying the emotions that you feel.
Yes, there's so much there. Thank you. That, and emotions, like, you can go back, I'm sure some of us already have, and I continually do this, go back to things that you've played for a very long time and have a completely different relationship to it as you develop as a musician, as you develop as a human. So, and I agree, the idea, oh, play with emotion, the writer wants us to convey this message. The beautiful thing about playing improvisational music is that really the message is in your hands, and we sort of remove the, sometimes the perceived notion of lyrics when we're playing instrumental music, or if we're scatting and things like that, like that lets us really remove any other type of external notion of what the music is about and make it our own. But yeah, you're right. It does come down to learning and how to process your own emotions. And the last thing I wanted to hear when I was in school was it takes time, because I didn't want to have to take time. I wanted it now because there are so many people already better than me. I'm already behind. It's just a recipe for things kind of getting to the point of exhaustion again.
Hey, Emily, I do have a question for you and for sure. the all the cats in the class. Like, previously, a few minutes ago, we kind of talked about processing your feelings leading up to the bandstand, because there's always that voice in your head, and you guys can tell me if you experience this, that, you know, before you even get to the bandstand, you have these feelings maybe of self-doubt or over-criticism. And what are some ways that you kind of, because that can kind of lead you down a dark path too. What are some ways that you guys can use to kind of get out of your head and to get into the zone, into your safe space to you know, really be creative? Any volunteers? What about John? We haven't talked to you.
How y'all doing? I'm sorry. My name is John. I go to Warren Eastern, and yeah. Oh, and I play drums and multiple instruments. But I do have a lot of self-doubt when I'm playing, like, the drums or playing any instruments. I do have a lot of self-doubt, and I do be self-conscious about a lot of things. But to get into my safe space, to be honest, I just close my eyes and breathe and take a deep breath and just let everything go. And also, I'm very religious, so I pray before I do anything. And then I just play and then hope for the best. That's how I honestly feel in my safe space and just feel relieved before I do anything.
Nice. Yeah, I like that. What do you do, Emily?
Whew, this is a tough one. John, thank you so much for your answer. You guys are just transitioning to the next part of everything so beautifully. Thank you. You said the next answer already. So you guys are super intuitive. I love it. What do I do? So the thing that I have a really hard time saying nice things to myself. I'm usually, my default is just, let me just remind myself how awful I am as often as I can. Not a good default for sure. The thing that I've come to realize is the way that I can be nicer to myself is that I pretend like I'm saying something to my younger self, something that I needed to hear when I was growing up. And I can be nicer to her, that version of me. I can't really process how to be super kind to myself all the time, but I do know how to be nicer to a younger version of myself. So if I get into that negative space where I'm beating myself up, I go back and I think about, okay, what did I need to hear? And how does that affect me now? It's probably what I need to hear now too. It's just easier to say it to a person that I feel a little bit more removed from, somebody who I don't feel as critical of, and somebody who I've forgiven. So that's my current way of doing it. And then exactly what John said about breathing, that is absolutely critical. I'm a trombonist. Breathing is obviously necessary to play, but I tend to hold my breath in other scenarios, and I'll run out of breath just because I'm nervous. So I realize that I hold a lot of tension that way. So breathing, making sure that all of the functions of my body are responding to the breath and just focusing on breathing. Sometimes it's a lot to focus on the music, to focus on performance, being on stage, all of those aspects that can create a little bit of tension. If I can just let it go and focus on breath, absolutely necessary. Anybody else have some different coping mechanisms?
Donald had his hand raised.
Yeah, go for it.
What you got?
I feel like for me, like when I'm like at a jam session or like gigging, I feel like I try to get into like that mental space that like it's just me. I mean, that helps, but like clearly there's like people, you know, around you listening to you. So I feel like you have to like come to like a realization that like if you're playing for like other people, or like if you're playing for like oh, I'm just playing to like, you know, like show off or like something like that, like I feel like you gotta play like in an honest way. So like if you're playing like honestly to yourself, you know, playing the things that like you want to play, I feel like people will like see that and be okay with that, you know. So you just gotta accept yourself first, and then that helps, you know, like release some like insecurities of like maybe you think like, oh, what are they thinking of me? Mm-hmm. But like as long as you're honest, then like people will be, you know, cool with what you do.
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely think that that's evident, as especially as you grow and play with more people and get to know people like more personally on a musical level, that as that relationship develops, I think you can hear honesty in the music too. And sometimes honesty is hard. Sometimes it's that you don't really understand or have like a really deep relationship to the music that you're playing. So you gotta kind of find ways to make your relationship to the music personal, even if it's something that you might not want to be playing. Going to your own space is something beautiful. I've definitely found myself closing my eyes and imagining like, what if only good things came out of my horn? And what if I didn't train wreck, you know, or whatever the worst case scenario that I always think of is. I think of the best, try and think of the best case scenario. What if the right person was at this gig who called me to do the gig of my dreams right now? What if I only played the exact things that I wanted to play? So personalizing it that way too, and like making it a little internal, right? Like imagining that you're not playing for everybody else, but you're playing from your own honest space. Definitely, that's a beautiful way to do that. I think part of what we do on stage is we process emotions, right? I've definitely heard people say like, put more feeling into it, put more emotion into it, right? That's no easy task. And we can't fully process emotions on stage either. So while we may express, I think the part of it then that's really helped me is understanding that there the expression of the emotion is part of it, but then completing the emotion is actually a physical response. So there are some ways that the book lists and things that I've had a lot of success with, especially relating to stress. I tend to take on huge projects and then get like really sick afterwards. I'm a migraine sufferer, and I can almost always count on turning in a project and having a migraine immediately after. I just thought it was my way of living, but it turns out it's actually my body's response to stress, and it's not sustainable. Do not recommend. But these are the things that have definitely helped me, and I'd like to go over some of them with you, but also I want to hear some ideas that you have. The concept of emotion is that you have to physically process it. So the first and most efficient way is to actually go do physical activity. What it does is it tells your body that you're processed it, you've gone through it, and there's a lot of other chemicals and hormones and things that happen in your body when you do exercise. That is the most efficient way to do it. I know that we don't always have the opportunity to just like play on stage and then go for a run afterwards. So that's not the only way. And I know that I'm not a runner, but I found other things that I enjoy doing. So I know that physical activity is not always the best, most, you know, accessible response. The other one is, I know Greg loves running. Greg will have to tell you about how many bugs he ate running last night. So the most accessible option after going through stress is breathing, exactly what John said. That is your body's response. Like that is one thing that triggers your body to be like, okay, I'm safe. I'm not actually in danger. I have control over my respiratory system. And going to a good way to combine both of those options is actually having a yoga practice where you can physically exert yourself and practice breathing at the same time. There are a few more on this list, but I would like to hear from you guys. What are some things that you do to process your emotion?
How about we hear from Anthony Beavers?
I was actually about to type this out, but last semester when I was in college, I did try to start working out more and with like a few friends. It didn't last the whole semester, sadly, but I feel like it did help just going to get out and do physical activity, even though I did more of all around rather than running, which is what I used to do when I was just a kid. But I feel like it did help a little bit just to feel better.
Absolutely. I love that. Yeah, man. Yeah, how about definitely. Idri?
Let's see. Process emotion. Usually when it comes to processing emotion, I turn to music, whether it's listening to a song that's hype or listening to a song that's like, you know, get you in your feelings. I use music to process it because, you know, it's the way that I would like to communicate with people. So just having music there. And then when it comes to like physically, I will try to make music, whether it's going to the piano or just like playing my horn and trying to process what I feel through it.
Nice. Yeah, love
that. That's beautiful. I think that's actually something on the list that the book recommends too. Creative expression is absolutely something that you can do to process emotion. And it seems kind of counterintuitive if your creative expression is what's causing your stress and your emotion. So I think what it, how it interprets for us and how it works for me is that I do something creatively expressing myself that I don't have any judgment on, that it's not my trombone. It's not me writing music or playing the trombone or playing piano or things that I do that I am hypercritical of. It is like trying watercolor. It is like just doing, I'm trying to remember one thing that I tried to do this summer. Oh, this worked for me. I like to build Legos, you know? There are some things that just like, I don't have any judgment on, but it is a creative expression. I think we get so wrapped up in the idea that this is our love and this is our passion. And sometimes it's also our frustration and our stress. And we're trying to make it all work in one. So I think having some other spaces that we can go to is very necessary. Some other things that I would not have thought of that the book recommends and have worked. Some of them have worked, some of them have not. For me personally, they recommend a positive social interaction, going to talk to somebody that you feel comfortable with, that can trigger everything to feel safe, right? Laughter, this is one thing that they said is not necessarily just like, oh, haha, that's funny, but like full body laughter, like putting on your favorite comedian and just like cry laughing, you know, which is another thing that they recommended, crying. It's not my favorite thing, but I know a lot of friends who that is exactly what they need to finish processing the emotion. And that is technically why your body cries. Go ahead, John.
How you doing? To be honest, one thing I do instead of doing like physical activity or anything such as like moving, I actually got a space. Well, not a safe space in my house, but actually I just go outside and honestly just like look at the world and just think back on things I did or just think back about what's going on in life and just slow down. Instead of like moving and going faster, I just slow down and just think about what's going on.
Yeah, absolutely. Slowing down is definitely necessary. And sometimes it's very hard to do. I think my inclination is definitely, is definitely to speed up because I want to get away from it, right? But slowing down is absolutely something that is necessary. Go ahead, Pef.
Yeah, I think I have this great routine that really gets me like sort of going. You're talking about exercise. I'm fortunate enough to have found like an apartment that has like a private pool. And next to the pool is actually a shed. And so every morning I'll go out, I'll jump in the pool, wake up, and then I'll go in the shed and shed my horn. And when I get tired of doing it, when I start to, you know, quote unquote, burn out, maybe few, maybe an hour later or so, I'll go and jump in the pool, do some laps, get back out, and then continue playing my horn. And it just, it keeps me going. Like
that, you know, that is the most literal interpretation of it. You have an actual shed and you are actually going to do physical activity when you burn out. All of that is super beautiful. I see, hold on, Anthony, I know you're trying to raise your hand. Go ahead.
I feel like the number one thing for me is, like, no matter what you're doing, like, even if it's something you don't particularly like, mm-hmm. or something you're interested in, just doing things with friends.
Yeah.
Just trying to hang out with people that, I guess, make you happy. And
yeah,
no matter what, that seems to cheer me up.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I know we have to transition, but I want to make sure that I give you guys your stuff for Thursday. So just to go over again the things that the book recommends and things that I have loved trying. The list is working out, breathing, positive social interaction, laughter, physical affection, crying, or creative expression. So I think if it's okay with you guys for Thursday morning, I'd like you guys to, and you don't have to share this with me, but before Thursday, I want you to come up with an action plan of how to incorporate some of these things into your daily practice. And no, don't say Emily is asking me to cry every day. Not at all. I want you to pick one of these that works for you. And then I want you to come up with sort of like an emergency strategy. Like, what are some things I can try when I'm really not feeling well? And I want you to definitely try some of these that you normally wouldn't. I normally would not cry because I don't like to, but getting myself to the point where I recognized that as a valuable form of my body's expression was very necessary and helped me ultimately discover what works best for me. So first thing, come up with your daily practice of doing some of these things so that you can process all of that emotion that we're supposed to be playing every single day. Two, come up with an emergency strategy. And then three, if you can, bring either paper or note cards, about 60 of them, for Thursday. And I put it in your folder too. But we're going to write some things on there, having just even like if you just want to cut squares of paper. 60 total, 60, yeah. I just get some note cards, like a pack of them from like Target or whatever. If you can't do that, don't worry. I'll come up with a way to randomize it on Google Docs, but the activity on Thursday works a little bit better if you have physical things to sort through. But if not, do not worry. I am not creating any extra stress. This is the anti-stress part of your week. okay. But I think that wraps up my end of it. I don't know if we have any time for additional questions, but
can I chime in for a sec? I can't figure out how to raise my hand on Zoom. I think. Zoom every day. I just wanted to throw in too, you know, therapy. As artists, you know, I've gone to therapy several times in my life, and I know there's like a huge social stigma against it, but as we're moving through time and in 2021, I feel like it's more common to talk about, you know, how everyone is, you know, therapy is an incredible, incredible thing. And for anyone who is ever encountering negative thoughts or feelings or emotions, or like, you know, noticing patterns in your life where you're like, hey, this keeps happening, you know, or whatever, I would highly recommend that you seek out a therapist, someone to talk to, someone that you trust. And I can say, you know, just in my personal experience, it's been one of the most beneficial, positive experiences and journeys in my life. And I hope that you know, I would suggest and recommend that to anyone who's going through anything, you know, in their lives. And there could be no negativity that comes out of it. But, you know, also as artists, I feel a lot of us, we kind of like, we associate our artistic accomplishments with our value as a human being. And, you know, we are not our art, you know, like our art is something that exists separate of who we are as people. And so I know it's a hard boundary to draw as artists. We always want to, like, you know, when we play a good gig, I'm a good person. If I played a bad gig, I'm a bad person. And I think as artists, if we can create that boundary in our lives, we're like, hey, no matter how the gig went, I'm still a good person. And, you know, the good gigs come, the bad gigs come, and they go. And as long as we can maintain that center with all the techniques and suggestions Emily was listening, those are all wonderful things. And finally, also, I just like to announce we'd be having a pool party at Pef's house at the end of the 2 weeks.
Yes. Yeah.
Let's go. Shed
no,
his pool.
Seriously, everyone's invited. Everyone,
that's amazing.
I'm not even joking. I'm not even joking. All
right. Thank you so much for being candid about that, Greg. I also highly recommend therapy. I see a therapist as well, and it's helped me immensely with my relationship to my music, to my friends, to my family, all of that. I think, like, let's remove the stigma from it as much as possible. It has helped me so much, and that is absolutely part of the positive social interaction, having a person that you can go to that you trust. Sometimes it's really hard to find that, so that is absolutely what's helped me, especially over the past year, for sure. So thank you, Greg.
Yeah, Emily, thank you so much. And yeah, thank you guys. The next class we have coming up. So wait, before we do that, everybody's clear what Emily needs from you for Thursday?
Any questions? Yeah, the two things, you can just write them down personally. I'm not gonna ask you to share that. That's a really personal thing. It's just a strategy for you to have. And I think it's a good thing to make sure you are accountable to yourself and have in place. The thing that I do need you to have is those 60 note cards or just 60 things to write down, separate things. We're going to be sorting through them and then something to write with. That's all.
Okay, cool. So next we got, thanks, Emily.
Thanks, guys.
See you on Thursday.
Sounds great. Thanks.
So we got a short break and then we got film scoring with Fima, who's a world-renowned film scorer. And so you do need to have some things downloaded. So you should check out his, I'm not sure, I think 7 of you are in his class. I'm not sure who's in his class and who's not. I'm not looking at the roster, but if you're not in his class, you want to hang, you can hang. But he should be here any second. But you do need to download the stuff from his folder, and you will need Logic to
that. Are you looking at a cup and put
Logic just disappeared from my computer.
Oh no.
I think I heard a couple other people so I know have it set up.
Can you
Dominic, if you go to the app store, you should be able to re-download it.
No, it's there listed for $200. I have to buy it. Yeah, I'm. I don't know what's going on.
Make sure. Actually, you know what? Make sure you're logged in the same email address that you purchased it with. Just double check that, and because you know when you purchase
Logged in. Jar from my change, because otherwise I find change all over the floor and it makes me insane.
This computer is from the Alice Marsal Center.
It's not your computer.
Yeah, and a couple other students there had the same issue. So I think it's just technical difficulties on their end.
Okay. Is there anyone you can contact over there? Because maybe they need to give you a different. They probably changed their login.
Well, I guess another person that had the same issue, they were able to fix the problem within like a day or so.
Okay.
They do something.
All right. So, you know what you can do in the meantime?
In between.
If you look in the folder, and you look in Genghis's folder, there's a link to a free DAW, FL Studios, and you can just download that DAW to use today.
When I'm done with school, I throw away all the.
And so, can you find it?
You know. Or I can probably just go to the App Store.
Yeah, actually, yeah, just do that.
What about
make sure it's the free version though. There's a free trial, so just do that one.
What about GarageBand? Does that have enough?
Yeah. You can try GarageBand and see how it works out.
The issue you might run into in GarageBand is you might not be able to sync sound with the video. You know, in Logic, they do have where you can have, like, you can put the video in there and see how it lines up with the audio. I don't know if you can do that in GarageBand, but maybe.
Well, there's no dialogue, so it should be cool. Because it's just...
And that one upstairs, right?
You know, but try GarageBand, and if it doesn't work, download FL Studios, but everybody should check out FEMA's folder. Okay, let me put the folder in the thing. Give me one second. So I think we're going to be scoring to Game of Thrones. Oh, wait. Oops. All right. There we go.
Who here is excited about going back to in-person stuff next year?
I know. Man, we really wanted this to be in person. Like, we were so on the fence. Like, can we do it? Can we not do it? But just with COVID, it was so unpredictable. And then at the last minute, it's like, okay, COVID's over. It's like, dang.
Man, I know. I appreciate you guys being here. I know y'all have been through it quite a many, y'all have logged many hours on Zoom and Google Class over the last year. So I appreciate y'all being here. But y'all, it's so hot outside. You don't even want to get out that net.
So let me see. Who be missing out of FEMA's class, Greg? You got the roster up? Oh, we must be missing a couple people. Everybody was able to get to the folder? Okay. All right, great. This one's going to be cool.
You know, I don't know if Ben's going to come to any of these classes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I put him in everything just because I know
he has everything. I don't know if there's someone else that maybe
Oh, Cam. Cam was supposed to be. Was Cam in here? I don't know if Cam is in here or not.
Cam Watson?
Yeah.
I think
Hey, Mr. Ajit.
What's up?
Do I stay in the same link, like, for the class transitions?
Yeah. All the links are the same. It's just one link for everything.
You're here.
Okay. Thanks.
Well, actually, you know what? Heywood, do you have Logic?
No, but I have FL.
Okay, and, that's fine.
You know, if you just want to hang, you're welcome to hang.
Yeah.
All right. Cool.
Fima, you ready? Let's see, he's still getting himself together.
I think I am, guys.
Okay, perfect.
Let's see. Am I ready? Oh,
yeah. Okay, you guys, this is Fima Chupakhin. And like I was saying before, Fima's kind of a famous guy, and he's won the equivalent of a Grammy.
No.
I mean, yes, you did. That's too much. No. I was nominated. It's Ukrainian Film Awards, which is kind of, it's a good, prestigious prize back in Ukraine.
Okay.
And it's, I guess, it's like anywhere if you doing any kind of like scoring work on the national level to get this recognition is cool, you know, even if you just nominated, but I did not win it yet.
Okay, cool. All right. So yeah, man, go ahead.
So, hello guys. I'm just trying to see, here we go. I'm trying to find this email with the roster of people. I hope everyone is present here. So I just want to welcome everyone. And thank you guys for joining. Like I said, to Darian, to the guys, that Logic is sort of a prerequisite for this workshop, but it's totally fine if you have something different. If your DAW is something different, it's fine. You are welcome to participate, and I guess, just so you know, it doesn't really matter which DAW you use to compose the music. What matters is your beautiful mind, your creativity, and what you actually compose. That's it. So you can do it anywhere. You can do it on iPhone. You can do it like
it doesn't matter these days too much. I guess the industry standard is Pro Tools when it comes to putting everything together. So it's cool if you know Pro Tools, and the majority of composers that I know and work in Logic Pro, and that seems to be sort of like DAW of choice, and I started with Logic, so that's why I'm fluent in this kind of thing, so I can do things quicker. So, but it doesn't mean that you cannot use like Reaper, Fruity Loops, Cubase, Studio One, or whatever else, or Ableton. So, I wanna actually, guys, can you give me just a little bit of a background of who you are and what instrument you play? If that's like super quick and stuff. I'm just like to remind you, I'm a guy from Ukraine. I've been living in New York for the last 6 years. And yeah, I've been doing film scoring for quite some time. And I just want to have a little bit of your background and the level of interest. And if you can mention the level of your compositional skills, like how much music do you love composing? What do you do? Do you make beats? Do you make music? Do you like just play and stuff like that? So just give me some of that if you can. Whoever wants to start first, just... I don't know, how do we do it in this Zoom realm? Do we like raise hands, or how do we
sometimes
do
this? You gotta pick the first person and say, you know what, you go.
Okay, I see Valerie. Hi, Valerie.
Hello. I'm Valerie. I play the guitar and the bass guitar. They're my main instruments. I write my own stuff. I play other stuff too. That's about it.
That's great. Okay. Thank you so much, Valerie. Nice to have you here. I see Haywood, but I don't see the... So, can you hear me, Haywood? If you can, tell me something.
Hi. I'm Haywood. Okay. My primary instrument is trumpet, and I make music, and the music I make is rap music and R&B and soul.
Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. Cool. Cool. All right, Brandon.
Hi, I'm Brandon. I'm a saxophone player, and I actually am a film scorer myself with two short films under my belt. So it's, and I'm still learning composing. I'm a beat maker as well. So it's a huge learning experience. You'll never stop learning. So.
Oh, man. Yeah, I've been doing it, and like I still don't know things, you know. I don't even know how
yeah.
I'm teaching. But I hope I'll teach you something. Thank you, Brandon. Okay, so then we have Seth. Hello, Seth.
Hey, how's it going? I'm Seth. I play piano. Over the past, I guess, year and a half, I've been writing a lot of music, like songwriting. And yeah, I just got Logic a couple months ago, so I was on GarageBand, so I kind of know my basics around Logic and everything, so yeah.
That's excellent. That's really good to know. All right, and now we have Dominic, right?
I've been using Logic for a while, and I usually I produce some beats on Logic, play mainly jazz music, classical music too.
Yeah, so you have like amazing background, all of you. All right, so what do you play, Dominic? You didn't mention what exactly you play. What instrument?
The main instrument I play is piano.
Piano. Okay, cool. Because I thought your main instrument is Logic, which is also a possibility for many people these days. Oh, and I see Matthew. Hello, buddy.
Hey.
Can you introduce yourself, and can you tell us what's your instrument and what's your background a little bit, just real quick?
My instrument is piano and organ as well, from New Orleans, and I just graduated from high school.
Could you be please a little bit louder, because I can hardly hear you?
I said I play piano, organ, and I'm from New Orleans, and I'm going into college.
That's very good. Okay, so guys, so just so you know, like, it's so cool because you already have experience with instruments. You know a lot already because there are a lot of people who start composing for film, being a little bit of a producer, maybe like playing a bit of the instrument, but it seems to me that you guys have like a deeper knowledge of your instrument, which is great. And there are many composers, I think, who was that? I believe Brandon, no, not Brandon, someone else, Haywood, you mentioned you play trumpet. So Terence Blanchard is an amazing trumpet player, and he established himself as a great film composer as well, you know. And Alessandro Desplat is one of my favorite composers too, and he plays flute, you know. And there are so many composers who play piano and who just conduct with awareness of many instruments. So basically, the more you know, the better. So the more you know about your own instrument, about other instruments, the better your perception, the better your ability to create something for those instruments, and it's going to sound good because of the knowledge that you have about the ranges, about the possibilities of instruments that you're writing for. Okay, so since this is not a, like a compositional per se course, I just want to, and also I want to apologize in advance for my pronunciation. I'm trying my absolute best, guys, and it's a challenge for me. So, but I hope you can understand me. If you cannot, tell me. Tell, oh my God, Fima, we cannot understand a word you're saying. That's fine. Okay. So, Mr. Host, whoever is host, the Zoom says that host disabled participant screen sharing. And I would love to have the screen sharing option if that's possible. I don't know who's like who's here who can help us with that. Gregory or Darian, if you guys hear me. So I'm for some reason I'm unable to share the screen. It's okay. We can go forward. And so my question to you guys, what do you think the, okay, here we go, now it's better. Okay, that's good. All right, so can you see my screen, guys? Cool. So this is the question, which seems to be quite obvious, right? But we need to somehow answer it. So what do you think is the role of music in picture? Like whoever comes, whoever wants to say anything, maybe, you know, just go for it. Unmute yourself and go for it and tell me.
Setting a scene.
Yes.
Suspense or foreshadowing.
That's good. All right, I have this claim that I made, which is to support or enhance the story. So it can be like what you're saying is very valid as well. So what else, guys?
I feel like it kind of brings the movie to life in other ways.
Yes, yes. Bring it to life. This is good. Exactly. Which I say I still kind of like, I would put that into the support in the story, right? Because you, what you're trying to do is bring to life a director's vision, basically. Okay, what else? Anyone? Don't hesitate, guys. It's fine. You can say whatever. It's just like whatever you feel. Because the more you understand or not or don't understand about this thing, the better. Because if you don't, I can explain. If you do, that's already a big bonus. So don't hesitate, and you know it's fine. It's a safe space.
I was gonna say like show emotion.
Showing emotion. That's good. Yes. Okay. I have this for you, which is I have it, but it's not doing anything.
Distracting the audience. How about that?
Distracting. Huh. It's interesting that you say distracting because...
Yeah, because you know like when you're watching a scary movie, the music sometimes distracts you from what is about to happen, where sometimes you can't tell, like, you know somebody's about to come out and get stabbed in the head, but you can't quite tell where because the music is like, you know, all flowy and it's not... you know.
Well, yeah, it's interesting, yes, that you say distracting, because usually what we're trying to do is to glue the audience to the screen so they just like forget everything but what's happening in front of them. But yes, you can say distracting. I put to set the tone also because the audience has to be placed. We have to be placed in the environment of the film, right? Be it like some kind of historic situation, be it just like today's situation or something, music gives us a sense of place, and it gives us a sense of like, oh my God, there's like something really terrible is about to happen right from the start, you know? So it grabs our attention. Thus, this is the claim that I make to engage the audience. It's kind of what you are saying, Darian, but like, even distracting the audience, we still engage in it. So the primary role of music are like these things that you just voiced and this that you can see on the screen right now, right? Because we need to support the story, we need to set the tone, and then we develop it throughout the film. We never lose it, you know, we kind of like carry our attention throughout this like an hour and a half or 2 hours or maybe a short film for 3 minutes, you know, and stuff like that. And we try to be engaging because, you know, like sometimes directors, they would make a joke saying that, okay, maybe my film is terrible, but let's see if the composer can save it. That's the worst situation for you guys. But, you know, because you basically have to like save the picture. But it happens rarely, especially if you are involved in good projects, you know. So it's not a big problem, but it has to be engaging, right? Because one of the things that a director wants is to make sure that when we watch the film, we are not quite distracted. So we do not check our phone. We really immersed in the picture, right, in the story. So, and the more we can help make it happen, the better we are. Okay, so my next question to you guys, and to myself, actually, when I was preparing this presentation, I had to like go through things to kind of like put in words what I know and what you maybe not necessarily able to put into thoughts sometimes. But what does the music actually do? Like, here's the film, we see the like first title, and what happens? Music sounds, and what does it do? Why is it there? You know, because it has to score something, right? It has to like somehow be connected, first of all. So I came up with this kind of principles that I think are legit, you know, and it's actually pretty helpful in understanding what to do when you are faced with the task to score something. So music underscores what directly is happening in picture, right? It's sort of like mimicking what is happening. Like you see a guy running, you know, the music is okay. It's like it's suspenseful, it's active. It's basically it's kind of like it's mimicking what's happening in picture. It's very common for action scenes. It's very common for like fights, battles, chase scenes, and stuff like that, right? I have an example, and let's see how it's going to work. I have actually 3 examples that are pretty cool, I think. And I hope we will be able to listen to them. Yeah. First, we will have to obviously listen to the advertisement, which we will try to skip. Okay. 1 second.
Hang on! I'm coming!
it's clear, right? Did you see what I just played? Just tell me, guys. Yep. Okay, so this is one of the options. You know, it's pretty active, and it goes throughout the scene. You know, we see some active battles from this movie. The music is just as epic as the picture. It basically tells us the same story, right? It's engaging, and it's fitting the scene. You know, it's working pretty well with the sound design around and stuff. So there's another example that I did, which is this cool car chase scene from Matrix. It's the second Matrix. If it will allow me to play it without. So, again, as you can see, and can you hear it well? Just kind of nod if you can or if you cannot. Is it good? Okay. It's a very active scene. Things are happening fast. The music supports it in a very direct, straightforward way, right? The cars are running. The music is... There is like... There are different levels of intensity, and this is something that we will talk about later. But basically, it is kind of the same as the picture, right? In a sense, it's the only difference between, for instance, those two things is actually this one is called more hybrid score because I think it incorporates, at least to my ear right now, more of the synth and like action drums. Things than the previous clip I showed, and both are quite orchestral scores. Again, there is another example, which I think is a very, very good example of chase scene and of how the music works for that particular chase scene and how the music works around the dialogue and sound design. So when I say things like dialogue, you understand what I mean, right? It's pretty clear. So when people talk, we should be able to understand what's going on, what they're talking about. If people don't talk, like just in this scene Matrix, right? Everything is action. Sound design becomes just as important as the dialogue. So you work your way around these two. So music becomes the third important part, but it's actually, at least to my experience, it's never quite the main part unless a director wants it to be a main part, especially in modern movies. You know, sound design plays a huge role in that. You know, all kind of like this fist fighting, this like sounds of cars and guns and stuff. It's all tied together with the music, really tight, you know. So, let me see, guys, there's this another scene. Yeah, I don't think I can find it easily. Yeah, this is the one. The secret. Okay, 1 second. The reason why I'm playing it from YouTube and not from like Spotify or some other places is because I want to share this presentation that I have. This is a keynote presentation. I hope you will be able to use it, even if you don't have Macs. I might do like just a PDF with the links or something, so I can share it afterwards. Because afterwards, in the folder that you have, you're gonna have two files. I'll try to make it available tonight. You're going to have a Word document that is called Resources, where you will find a lot of things that I put together for you, because I want you to be aware of certain like VST libraries, whether free or paid, certain things, certain like YouTube guys who like provide with excellent tutorials for logic, for mixing, for mastering and stuff like that. So because basically as film composers, we guys like do we do a lot. I'll show you how like a typical session looks when you have to do everything. When you first do a MIDI mockup, then you'll have to record live people unless you play the instrument. For instance, I don't play trumpet, so I had to record trumpet, trombone, and you know, horns. But I also play piano, so I don't have to do that and stuff like that. So it's these days you have to be as skilled as you can be in order to basically deliver the final result. Be it a final result for your schoolmate who is just doing like animation 1 minute, you know, for his mom or something, you know, still it's your client in a sense, you know, and you have to be able to give him or her your absolute best, your music, and it has to be you know, it has to sound as the final result. Okay, so this is a scene. We are back to our first approach, which is like illustrative or commenting or mimicking. So this is from Inception. I don't know if you've seen this movie. Just this chase scene, just to kind of like elaborate on the point of active music that really supports what's going on and that is really in tune with what's what we are seeing. Also, I want you to try to notice the different levels of intensity for this scene. How music drops, how it comes back, how hard it comes back, how soft, what's happening, is this like a dense kind of track or it's more sparse track and stuff like that. Just try to pay attention for that for a second and see if you can. Okay, I think they start somewhere here.
Man at the bar.
Coble Engineering. That price on my head, was that dead or alive?
Don't remember. See if he starts shooting.
Run interference, I'll meet you downstairs in the bar and say, say half an hour.
We're back here.
It's the last place they'd suspect.
Freddy! Freddy Simmons. My God, it's you, isn't it?
Who? No, it isn't.
You're not dreaming now, are you?
Hey, can you hear me, guys? Something dropped with the sound in the clip. I don't know why. This is enough to illustrate the point, but I hope you noticed, you know, the moment he enters that cafe, the music drops and it stays intense, you know, so like it just like keeps us in check, keeps us engaging, and the second these guys coming in, the music comes back in like a full force, and then it just like develops a little bit, and it's always like basically to keep us engaged, right? So we are not losing this intensity because the director, Christopher Nolan in this case, wanted, you know, it to be like that, you know? He wanted, like, our attention drawn to the scene. So, like, we, like, follow the protagonist as much as we can. And so this is our job in a sense, you know, like, and sometimes it's easier, sometimes it's harder, you know, and but because this is this like silver line to find a proper amount of music to work around cool sound design, because sound design people are gonna hate you if you doing something bad, you know, because these guys like spend quite some time in order to like get those like sounds of like fights and stuff, and they want the music to like really enhance that too, especially for scenes like that. Okay, so I'm gonna move on. I'll reserve some time for any kind of QA guys that we might have, because I really want to get to like this cool part. So there's another approach that is basically not as literal. It's when the music takes a characteristically different side in regard to what is happening in picture, thus creating a clear contradiction to the character of the scene. I call it everyone calls it a counterpoint approach, right? We see fast action, slow music, seemingly sad scene, happy music, and vice versa. It's very also common for like violent scenes to have like some kind of ironic music that is like, if you take these two together, they're very different. They're so different, but in combination, these two different things create some sort of like connected, a very interesting feeling, and which is totally different from the straightforward approach. Okay, a good example could be this, I think. Not this exactly. Okay, we'll have to wait the ads, guys.
There's a world outside of Yonkers, way out there beyond this hick town, Barnaby. There's a slick town, Barnaby, out there. Put on your Sunday clothes, there's lots of world out there. Get out the brilliantine and dime cigars. We're gonna find adventure in the evening air.
So, you see this seemingly desolate earth, full of garbage, full of trash. Everything is so sad looking, so gray, and yet this song is so uplifting and so lovely, as if we're having the best time. We're like traveling into some kind of almost a paradise-like place. This is one of the examples, right? And I believe I have this kind of... There's another example, which is we see this kind of serene, beautiful images accompanied by like absolutely ominous, terrifying music. So this music sets this terrifying tone to this picture. This is the opening for The Shining. It's a great movie by Kubrick. And it's a great use of this counterpoint approach. You can take like two different things that are seemingly disconnected, right? And make them create such a feeling that looking at this like, you know, I call it like, you know, like this, especially this picture, like a wallpaper for like the, you know, for your laptop screen that is like so serene and nice and calm, and it just like looks terrifying with this music, and I'm like, I'm shivering because I don't know what's going to happen. And this is the effect that a director wants to achieve, right? There's also a cool scene. I like this one, this example. I think this is from X-Men, right? It's the way they use again.
Somebody move! Hold it right there!
Charles?
Don't move! Hands up! Or we will shoot!
Freeze him, Charles.
I can't.
Hands up!
If I could save time in a bottle, the first thing that I'd like to do is to save every day till eternity passes away, just to spend them with you. If I could make days last forever, if words could make...
You get the point. It becomes funnier and more interesting to watch because what they did is they started with the like serious action-like straightforward approach, like, oh my god, you know, which is like, okay, action film, and then switch to a song like that. This is amazing, I think, really. And this is why, guys, it's important to be aware that this approach exists, because when you are discussing which way to go with the director, you know, it's going to be very helpful for you to be aware that you can go actually many different ways, right? And not just like be super straightforward and just score what is already there, because what directors usually are looking for is to add in depth and width and another dimension to their film, which is you. Okay, so now what do we have? Okay, so we have like this one is going to be pretty easy, and we're going to go through like maybe one example of each. This is the approach when music serves as a representation of a person by means of assigning a musical motive to a character, right? So the musical theme has to be coherent and strong enough as to retain its recognizability when modified throughout the film. Basically, I create a leitmotif for each character. I get inspiration for this approach is Star Wars, right? That we are all aware of. Even if you haven't seen the movie fully, or like maybe you guys seen like one part or something, you know, you know all those themes because they're all around, because they were great. And this so-called leitmotif approach is very useful when you try to create basically like a theme for each character, so we can identify them as the audience. Oh, this guy comes in and the music sounds, you know, this type of music sounds, or this like lady comes in and here is her theme. So this idea comes from, you know, it's old, very old. It comes from the opera world. It comes from Wagner. It comes from like those people who were like creating operas when they didn't have like much visual effects at the time. So the strong themes associated with characters, it's a great approach, especially in television. I would say it's working amazing for series. Maybe not so much for like just sort of one movie, but when you have like a multi-part movie like Lord of the Rings, Star Wars, or some kind of TV series, there's always some kind of a theme. So, I mean, let's take a look at this one, and just quickly, just one example, which I love so much.
Thank you.
with him breathing, this like Darth Vader march is probably one of the most recognizable leitmotifs in the world, right? I think, yeah. So it's, you know, the composer John Williams created like an amazing body of music for this film. And it's just, it's also terrifying, you know, it's very fitting the character. It's very good, you know, and it sticks. And it can, as you may notice, I didn't play it from the beginning, the first clip, but there are like two scenes. So this motif, like I said before, has to be strong enough so it can actually survive reiterations or some kind of rework around that motif throughout the film. Okay. I want to show you, like, there are more things like that. You will look at the presentation because I feel like I'm running a little bit behind the time that I assigned for this. I wanted to talk a little bit about some different stuff. So the leitmotif, I just wanted to mention, it can be assigned to pretty much anything, guys. It shouldn't be only... And I actually, when I attended a very nice film scoring workshop at NYU, they pointed out at this famous Netflix series Crown, where Hans Zimmer was asked to just compose the main theme, main title, which is beautiful, but another composer was doing all the work, as we say, you know, all the work of like, you know, scoring like 20 episodes or like 5 seasons, or I don't know how many. So basically, having a main theme gives identity to the dramatic work, right? To the series, to you know, a multi-part movie, and so on. So I wanted to play this. Also, I think one of the most recognizable main titles ever. The reason why I brought it up, guys, is because so you can understand what music actually does, okay? So there's another thing that I wanted to talk about before we jump into the actual project that we have, right? So we covered two approaches, right? Actually, three approaches. One is the more literal, which is basically mimicking what's going on in picture. Another one is kind of like you take the opposite side or characteristically different from what is in the picture. And somehow, by doing something different from what is in the scene, you create the desirable effect that director is looking for, right? And another approach is leitmotivic, right? When you assign a melody, a motif, a rhythm, whatever, a sound to a character or to a group of characters or to something, to object, to idea, and so on and so forth. These three principles, guys, are actually very, like, probably that's enough for you to understand what to do at this level. Because it can get complicated when you score, like, every good score bears something from each approach. You know, it's not just like, okay, we are straightforwardly doing this. It's like, it's a combination of things, right? And we also, sometimes we see people laughing in the scene, but the music is terrifying because the music maybe scores hatred, that's growing between these people that they are not aware of yet, you know. And these are all these things that I just wanted to say that you are never in the dark, you know. These things are something that director reveals to you because you are his or her best partner. You're like brother, sister to him, because you guys synergy that happens between you is very important, you know, this communal mutual energy, because if it doesn't happen, it's going to be really tough, you know, for you to score a movie for a person that you do not establish proper professional, first of all, relationships. Okay, so is a quick overview of like how to do your absolute best in bringing that director's story to life. You should ask as many questions as you need to really understand a director's vision for music in her or his film, right? Because if the director tells you from the start, I want an ukulele soundtrack throughout the whole 1 hour movie, so that's what you're gonna do. That's it. Don't try to convince him or her that you need an epic orchestra sounding soundtrack if what he's looking for is a ukulele with like two piano sounds. That's it. Again, like I said, you're never in the dark. There are reference tracks, you know, and video editors, especially, not even directors, I mean, in a bigger production, video editors are your best friends, because they usually find amazing temp tracks. They're called temp tracks because it stands for temporary tracks that they cut the scene to, they edit the scene to, and then the director sees it, and it's good and bad. It's like a blessing and a curse. Blessing because you have the direction based on the reference track, and curse because they get so attached to temporary tracks that it's very hard to do something new. Okay, so, and you listen carefully to those references and try to figure out why these particular tracks ended up on the scene. Because these tracks, they contain that energy, that feeling, that something, that sound that the team is looking for. If there is not a clear understanding of which scenes need music, you always, there's always a spotting session with the director. You sit together, you spot, oh, this scene needs music. I feel like this would be nice with music, right? And then another part for you, for both of you, just for you to figure out how the music enters, when it enters, how it dies down, and when it ends. It's very important. Those are simple things, very, very important. You should just constantly communicate with directors so you're on the same page and you're not going into the wrong direction, overdoing things and doing unnecessary jobs, which I did a lot. That's, you know, you get too creative, you know, sometimes, because you're like, oh, I'm so excited, and then this and that, and then the director calls you next day and says, this is rubbish, I'm sorry, can we just go back to that very first idea that you recorded on your iPhone, you know? So that's how it goes. So, and the last thing I wanted to say is, be always ready to change anything in your score, anything. Don't get attached to your lovely ideas. Yes, you're a beautiful musician. Yes, you know a lot of things. That's all good. But please do not get attached too much, because it all changes very often, more often than you think. Okay, so chase scene is what we, I don't know, guys, have you looked at the folder? Okay, so the file that you need the most, I put Fima file there too, but you don't need that really. What you really need is two files. This is a Westworld clip. There was a competition, Westworld competition, plus Spitfire Audio. They did a competition last year, which a lot of composers entered because it was cool, you know, to win Spitfire Audio. For those who don't know, they create amazing VST libraries. Their orchestral libraries are truly one of the best. It's really unbeatable, and I love them. And I put a link to them and just some other things into the resources file, which you're gonna have soon. So they did this competition, and HBO gave this a little clip of music which we're gonna be using for our project. I'm just going to skip this presentation a little bit because I want you to, once again, give me 1 second. Just trying to get to next slide. Yes. So things to do before we even start composing, right? It's just like before you even start doing anything, you have your logic, right? You have your session. You'll have to do, I guess we're not going to do this for now. So what you're going to do is find your Westworld file, which is Westworld/305/clip-no-music. I hope you don't like who downloaded it already. Tell me. Okay, two people. Oh, maybe I don't see everyone.
Valerie, Dominic, and Brandon.
Okay,
Seth.
Brandon. Cool. Okay, cool. Thank you, guys. Four people. So, okay. So, if you haven't downloaded yet, please download. And you don't have to download the clip that is called TX72 because I mean, you can watch it online if you can, just right from the folder, so you can have a perception of what the original composer did. And it's actually the one of those contrapuntal approaches. You know, it's Wagner's Dance of Valkyries for that scene. It's a basically car chase scene that we're going to be doing, right? In a sense, it's a chase scene. So we're going to be using illustrative approach. At least I would recommend. You are welcome to do whatever you feel, but that's like probably because it's an active and action scene. Just be mindful that your music has to sort of like be in sync with picture in that realm. As I provided you with examples before, usually chase and action scenes are more like on the active side of music, okay? So that file, when you open it, so first you open Logic, right? You create new project. Let me do that. So Logic automatically creates a project and asks you to create a track, right? Whoever is doing it not in Logic, it's fine. Whatever you're doing is whatever you think is good, okay? So then you drag this file right into the Logic. And then you follow the prompts that... Okay, I'm canceling. I just want to do it here. So you can see it. Okay, look, you can see my screen, right? Okay, so you just follow this prompt. You use 48 kilohertz. It may ask you to do a different frame rate. It shouldn't, but it might. You just press OK and go with it. So here, the clip that HBO provided, it's already, as you can see, it's synced to bar one. So your scene starts at the bar one. You know, it's not always the case when you get a scene, you know. So usually, like, we composers, we sync it ourselves. So, like, the beginning is bar one. I will elaborate about that, about syncing in SMPTE position, it's called, for the next time. Right now, what I want to give you is just this overview, right? So you ended up with this thing. You have a dialogue track here, which you can mute and work around. And
I'm approaching now.
Yes. So this is the scene. For those of you who haven't downloaded it yet.
Verified. Enable semi-automatic control. Disable safety features. Maximum speed. Go. What's happening to him?
I think he's switching genres.
We need distance. Head south.
Okay, guys, what I want you to do is at least score the first minute. The scene is long. It's 4 minute scene. You know, it's pretty long. So like if you can come up with ideas for the first minute, that would be amazing. All I need for the second lesson from you is some ideas. And it's kind of funny to watch a scene like that without the music, really. Because it just like has nothing, you know, just for the contrast, let me play the scene with the music. It's the original composer of the movie, who is Ramin Djawadi. I mean, again, this, like from this Quicksilver example from X-Men, here it starts serious, like an action scene, and then it goes to this counterpunctual approach where like the classical piece is juxtaposed with what we see in the picture, and it creates like a beautiful, really beautiful car dance.
Verified. Enable semi-automatic control. Disable safety features. Maximum speed. Go.
It's an interesting choice for a car chase scene, you know, music wise. And so that's how it was originally on HBO for the Westworld. Okay, so this is the project, guys, that we're going to be working on. Before we end, and I want to ooh, sorry, that's a different thing. That's actually a commercial treatment that I got. So okay, so before we get there, yes, so what I wanted to do to give you that again, so we are using mostly illustrative or commenting approach, but you're welcome to try others. Just do not overthink the project and try to create engaging music that fits the scene and the music that you really like. Yes, I see a raised hand. Sure.
How do we get the files? I don't think I've received mine.
I thought that Darian.
The files are in FEMA's folder. Matthew, I put it in the chat a little while ago, but let me grab it again. Okay, I'll put it in the chat.
Also, guys, I'm so sorry. Like, it's so annoying on Zoom. I see that someone raises hand, but I don't see the name because I don't know the name yet of all of you. But I'll try to recognize you because there's not so many of you. So, Matthew, I'm sure. Yeah, so there is a folder. In that folder, you will see three files. One is my entrance, which you can disregard, really, because I don't want to be somehow like, you know, so you are tied to like my vision or something. This is the vision that that people had initially, like the HBO people, okay? So I just wanted to advise you to have like less is more. Remember about that. So you don't have to do too much. You know, just think about instrumentation. Think about your sound palette. And I assume that you are aware of some. We are using, so the reason why I said Logic, right? Because we're using stock plugins. We're using stock VST libraries. So we don't worry about third-party libraries. If you have them, that's fine. You can use them. You're welcome. but don't really sweat it too much in terms of like, oh, I need this action strike and like heaviosity damage too, and all those like fancy companies, you know, plugins that cost tons of money. Don't worry, you can still do amazing soundtrack and make it with like with all the available instruments in Logic. Which brings us and me to this point, which I wasn't able to cover. How are you guys in terms of MIDI editing? Okay, thumbs up I see from Seth, from Dominic. What about, okay, Brandon, I have no doubts, buddy. Heywood, how's the MIDI life? I can see him, but.
Can you repeat that, please?
Are you good with MIDI editing? Any questions about MIDI editing in the DAW?
I think so.
Okay, cool. All right. So just use the stock thing. And since we are in a draft stage of your ideas, so by next lesson, what I want you to do is to come up with some kind of basic grooves, riffs. Think about this as okay. So quickly. Chase scene tips. Every scene has a certain tempo, but it's not set in stone, and it's often up to a composer to find out what the tempo is the most fitting. So you can play this scene with a metronome, or drums, or just tap, or sing, whatever. So just to find a tempo that you think would be good for this scene. There's no, like I said, it's not set in stone. It's like, oh, the tempo is 100. No, it's whatever. So give way to dialogue. Remember that, right? Do not drown it in music, no matter how amazing your music is. You're also competing with the sound design. Remember, you instead of competing, work with it. Okay, work with it. Make it part of your score. You know, some cool hit, make it a part of what you're doing. Okay, so you literally glue the audience to every turn and twist of the scene, so keep it engaging. So remember about different levels of intensity. Somewhere your music should be very active, somewhere it should drop a little, you know, and then come back in an even more intense way. Dynamic is your friend. Loud, quiet, slightly quieter, abrupt, you know, dense structure, sparse structure, many instruments at the same time, few instruments, okay? Repetition is very good for things like that. Think of layers of rhythmic and melodic phrases that can create and propel motion, and think of them in small chunks, because it's like you're making a beat in a sense, right? There's a 2 to 4 bar phrases, no more than that. So you can like turn it off, and by turning it off for just like a few measures, you are already creating this like different variation, right? The intensity drops or it comes back, okay? So you can like juggle them on and off. And have like for yourself, even for this first minute, have some sense of form, start, development, some kind of like secondary climax and like ending, or like coming into the next shot, you know? Try to have a sense of form. Yes,
we got to wrap it.
Okay,
sorry, man. It's a lot. any questions, y'all, about the project for what's today? Tuesday for Thursday. Anybody got a question?
Yeah,
for Fima. Or for
please ask me. I'm sorry, there's no time for QA for now, but it's gonna be plenty of time. I'm gonna just shut up next lesson, and you guys are gonna be talking all the time.
Okay, I have a question since they don't. All right, so next class, they're each gonna have to present their work. To you?
Well, it would be nice if you can guys come up with at least a draft for one first 60 seconds. Like, okay, so I'm right. It could be like, you know, two MIDI files, you know, one is like do piano something. So this is the groove I'm thinking about, and this is like a couple hits around.
Okay.
That's good.
All right.
You know, because what I want to like eventually for the third lesson, I would want to hear a more complete version so we can start talking about mixing.
Okay.
Because all right. Like, yeah, that's it.
Okay. So you guys, everybody cool on that. Next time, have a rough draft of your piece, and then by the third class, we'll have it completely finished. be prepared to play it for us. So yeah, if you have any questions about sharing your sound and stuff like that, we can talk about it when we come back in an hour. Cool, everybody good?
Yeah. All right, guys, thanks. It's nice. It's a pleasure meeting you all. I wish you good luck. It's amazing, and I hope I was of some help.
Yeah, that was amazing, Fima.
Yes. All right. Thank you, guys. All right, okay. I'll see you Thursday. I cannot wait to see you again, really, because I have so much information that I haven't shared yet. But I promise. I'll give way to your questions more.
Okay. Great. Thanks, all right, brother.
Okay. Bye.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, y'all. We'll see y'all at 2 or at whatever time. I'm in New York. Whatever time.
1 o'clock. 1 o'clock.
1 o'clock. There we go.
See you at 2. We're not going to see anybody.
I know.
All right, guys.
Later, y'all.
Later. Peace.